Good evening, everyone. My name is Marcos Ortega, and it is a joy to be with you this evening. I am a teaching elder from the Presbytery of the East, and I have been on the World Outreach Committee now for a couple of years. It's been a great joy to serve on that committee and get to know many of our global workers on Zoom calls. But really, this is, for World Outreach, the high point of the week, because this is our commissioning service when we get to send our brothers and sisters into the world to proclaim the kingdom of Jesus Christ. And that's what we're going to be talking about tonight. But in the spirit of the next generation theme, I have my daughter up here, and she's going to read for us my preaching text for tonight. And so she's going to read, I will pray, and then the sermon will begin.
You know that I have not hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you, but have taught you publicly and from house to house. I have declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. And now, compelled by the Spirit, I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I only know that in every city the Holy Spirit warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Now that I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again, therefore I declare to you today that I am innocent of the blood of any of you, for I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God.
Amen. Thank you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here together worshiping you. We pray that you would bless the preaching of your word. Would your Spirit be at work? Would he be at work in me? Lord, would you clarify anything I say that is unclear? Lord, would anything I say that is untrue be quickly forgotten? And Lord, would you be glorified? Be glorified, Lord, in the preaching of your word. Be glorified in the sending out of these global workers to do your work among people who have never heard the name, that beautiful name, Jesus Christ. Father, we love you, and we thank you for the privilege of joining in worship this evening. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. About 15 or 20 years after our Lord's crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension, Saul and Barnabas found themselves in a small worship gathering in Antioch. Now, this was their home church. It is where, according to Luke's account in Acts 13, both of them had been set apart as prophets and teachers, or what we might call today elders. This was a session meeting, if you will, of people who were gathered together in worship. Now, Antioch is an important city. It's a powerful city in the history of the Christian church, because when the church gathered in Antioch, there really was no defining characteristic about the people who were together. Luke's account of that room in Antioch describes people from different areas in the Roman Empire, different accents, different experiences, different countries. There was nothing that would have put them in that room together except for Jesus. And so it was in Antioch that the followers of Jesus were first called Christians. Luke gives the report about what happened among these Christians so short after the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. Here's what he says. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." And to confirm that this was the will of the Spirit, Luke tells us that the leaders continued fasting and praying. And then they laid hands on Saul and Barnabas, they prayed for them, and they sent them off. This was the very first missionary commissioning service in the history of the Christian church. That was the work to which the Holy Spirit had called Saul and Barnabas. It was missionary work, and we know this because they left from that place in Antioch and they set off on what we now call Saul's or Paul's first missionary journey. But how do we understand the content and the character of Paul's missionary work? Or better yet, how did Paul himself understand the content and character of his work? After all, tonight what we will do is we will lay hands on our brothers and sisters and we will send them off to countries all over the world as missionaries, as global workers, to proclaim the kingdom of Jesus Christ. So as you go in the spiritual lineage of Paul the Apostle. So if you go in the lineage of Paul, it would benefit you to understand how Paul saw himself as a missionary. What was the content and the character of his work, of your work? To answer that question, we are going to turn to a passage that my daughter just read for us from Acts chapter 20. It is a passage that has fundamentally changed the course of my ministry, and I pray that it will be encouraging to you. Now, this sermon, I admit, will be easier for you if you have a Bible in front of you. And so if you have a Bible, an old-fashioned one like this in paper, feel free to grab it out or one on a device. Acts chapter 20, we'll be looking really at the entire farewell address that Paul gives to the Ephesian elders, but we're going to narrow in on just a couple of key ideas. Now, I remember first hearing this passage exposited while I was studying at Westminster Theological Seminary in Philadelphia. And there was some excitement in the room when we were all gathered in Rust Auditorium because there was a different professor that was going to be there than we had expected. You see, we had all enrolled expecting for one of the preeminent New Testament scholars there to present the class, but then he went on sabbatical, and we were all a little bit disappointed until we heard that they'd brought in a guest professor, and he had quite the Westminster pedigree. He was a man who had taught there for years before, teaching the section of my seminary education would be Dr. Richard Gaffin. And Dr. Gaffin's class, that class was definitive for my theology. In fact, you could say that those lectures were among the most impactful lectures of my entire seminary career. Now, this sermon is my own, so if you hate it, you can't blame Dr. Gaffin for it, okay? But I am certainly leaning on some of his insights in what you're going to hear tonight, and I want to make sure that I say that up front. So let's consider the text. And let's do so by asking a question. How did Paul understand the content and character of his missionary work? Well, the passage begins with him saying, I haven't hesitated to preach anything that would be helpful to you. I've taught publicly and from house to house. I've declared to both Jews and Greeks that they must turn to God in repentance and have faith in our Lord Jesus. But as he continues to speak, he starts to get to the core of his understanding of his entire gospel ministry. He says he feels compelled to go to Jerusalem and he doesn't know what's waiting for him, but he knows it's not going to be good. And others have told him, don't go to Jerusalem, it's not safe, you don't want to do this, and yet he is compelled to go because, as he says, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task that the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. That was his mission statement. Testify to the good news of God's grace. But how do we testify, and how is that grace manifested? Well, in verse 25, he gives us an insight. He's explaining that he's never coming back to see the Ephesian elders again, and he says, I know that none of you, among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom, will ever see me again. Among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom. So how does he testify as a witness who has experienced something? How does he testify to the work of God's grace in his own life and in the life of the people around him? What is his testimony? It is a proclamation of the kingdom of God. That is the substance of his message. That is the content of his gospel. It is a proclamation of the kingdom. And it is the same message that was proclaimed by Jesus in his earthly ministry. There was a movement a while back, and once in a while it raises its head again to say, no, Jesus and Paul were preaching two different gospels. Jesus taught the gospel of the kingdom, and Paul taught the gospel of justification. But Paul is saying, I am preaching the kingdom. So what Jesus, his proclamation of the kingdom, what he passed down to Paul, it dominated the entirety of his ministry. In fact, when you go to the end of Acts, what does Luke tell us? But that he is there under house arrest proclaiming the kingdom. And when he gives Timothy his charge to preach the word, it is in light of the appearance of Christ and the coming of his kingdom. It is the proclamation of the kingdom that we pass down from generation to generation. It is the proclamation of the kingdom that was Christ's gospel, that was Paul's gospel, that was Timothy's gospel, that is your gospel as you go into the world. You are called as global workers to go into the world proclaiming the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Richard Gaffin put it this way. He said, Paul is the explicator of the kingdom proclamation of Jesus. And Herman Ritterboss, he made it even starker. Paul does nothing. He does nothing but explain the eschatological reality, which in Jesus' proclamation is called the kingdom. Gaffin and Ritterboss were clear. And I believe that the scriptures are equally clear that what Paul is doing is unpacking through all of his letters and through all of his preaching and through all of his ministry, he is unpacking this beautiful idea, the kingdom of God. And he's laying it out before people. And he's proclaiming that salvation is in Christ, and when we are saved, we are entered into a kingdom. And that kingdom proclamation, Paul takes even further, and he calls it the entire counsel or the entire will of God. He says, I know that none of you among whom I've gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. Therefore, I declare to you today that I'm innocent of the blood of any of you. Nobody can look at Paul and say, you didn't give me the gospel. That charge cannot be laid at Paul's feet. He says, I am innocent of the blood of any of you, for I have not hesitated to proclaim or to preach the whole counsel of God. The whole counsel of God. Now, the kingdom of God is what we alternate, it's an alternate reality that we call the age to come. And that age to come is laid atop the reality we lived in before we came to Christ. We call that this present age. That's how Paul describes it. The kingdom of God, then, is another way of living and loving and thinking and being by which we are being shaped more and more day by day by the power of the Holy Spirit into the image of our King, Jesus Christ. So what we are doing when we go and we share the good news of Jesus Christ is we are offering an alternative life that is marked by hope and peace and unity with our fellow brothers and sisters. A way of life that is better in every way than the other ways of living that the world may offer. It's a kingdom that brings all things into view. It's comprehensive. Here's Gaffin again. He notes that the phrase, the whole will or the whole counsel of God, that in that phrase, the comprehensiveness of the kingdom comes about. These are not different sectors of the whole counsel of God. Rather, to proclaim the whole counsel of God is to proclaim the kingdom of God that has a gospel focus in the grace of God as it involves calling people to repentance toward God and faith in Christ. We are offering another way of being to the world. But we have to offer more than an alternative because the world is filled with people that are offering their vision for a better life. And when you go into the world proclaiming the kingdom of Jesus Christ, you can't just offer yet another alternative to the many alternatives that are out there. You need to be able to demonstrate. You need to be able to prove that this way, the way of Jesus, is superior to all the other ways. So what is our proof? What is our apologetic? Our apologetic is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That's our apologetic as we share the kingdom. Gaffin again, Paul, we can say, explicates the kingdom proclamation of Jesus with its already not yet structure by centering it on the death and resurrection of Christ in their eschatological significance. That is, that the death and resurrection of Jesus are the initial entry point of the kingdom of God into this present age. When Jesus raised from the dead, he brought with him a resurrection life that transforms all who believe. Which means we cannot speak of the kingdom of God without recognizing that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the historical moment that the kingdom of God arrived, even if it's not yet experienced in its fullness. And so our apologetic is the death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus. The resurrection, faith in the resurrection, is what enters us into the kingdom life. You cannot enter if you do not believe in the death and resurrection of the Son of God. That is the gate, that is the justifying need for all sinners, is to believe in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, which cleanses us from our sins and gives us a resurrection life that we live out in what we call the kingdom of God. The preacher in Hebrews, he puts it this way: we see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a little while, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. So he goes into death and then he rises. He is crowned, notice the king language, he is crowned with glory and honor. But he does not go into glory alone. In bringing many sons and daughters to glory, the preacher continues, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. And so when Jesus rises, we, by faith, rise with him. We enter into this resurrection life. It is through our union with Christ that we are justified, sanctified, glorified. Paul says this in the famous verses in 1 Corinthians 15. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. And he continues in 1 Corinthians 15 to say that Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. The first fruits. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. He's hammering at union with Christ, that it is in union with Christ that we are saved. And it seems that the point is made. He's made his point. But chapter 15 doesn't end there. Paul keeps going. And Paul gets into this interesting rhetorical device. He says, the body that's sown perishable is raised imperishable. It's sown in dishonor, it's raised in glory. It's sown in weakness, and it's raised in power. It's sown a natural body, it's raised a spiritual body. He's giving you this back and forth, these two categories of kinds of people. He even makes it explicit. It is written that the first man, Adam, became a living being, category one. The last Adam, category two, a life-giving spirit. First man was of the dust of the earth, the second man is of heaven, and just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man. So you have these two men, the earthly and the spiritual. The one who was marked by Adam, the one who was marked by the last Adam. Why is he doing this? It culminates in verse 50. I declare to you, brothers and sisters, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Paul is teaching clearly here that it is in union with Christ that we have now access to the kingdom. that our justification is not the end of the road. I was raised in a broadly evangelical church, and the focus that we had was, how do we get people saved? How do we get people saved? How do we get them justified, if we were to use a theological word? And the focus was so heavily on that that we forgot about everything that comes afterwards, the rest of the Christian life. But Paul is saying that your justification, your being united with Christ and raised with him, is the starting gun. It is the beginning of life in the kingdom. And we can only enter into this life, this new way of living and loving and thinking and being. We can't enter into that place called the kingdom of God apart from anyone other than Jesus Christ and being identified with his death and resurrection. He is our way to eternal life. And death and resurrection of Jesus bring us salvation because they are the gateway into the new way of being that we call the kingdom of God. But in this kingdom conception, the resurrection plays another role, a role that we need Luke's help to understand. The resurrection is not only our sign of entrance into the kingdom, it is the sign of kingdom superiority. Resurrection is the sign of kingdom superiority. And we know that it's a sign because of what Jesus himself calls the resurrection. He calls it the sign of Jonah. He does this in Luke 11, 14 and following. Now, the context of this is Jesus has been described, he has been casting out demons. And he is described as someone who is casting out demons by the power of demons. And he says, so that's absolutely impossible. Any kingdom, notice the kingdom language is here, any kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and a house divided against itself will fall. If Satan is divided against himself, how can this kingdom stand? I say this because you claim that I drive out demons by Beelzebul. But when a strong man, fully armed, guards his own house, his possessions are safe. But when someone stronger attacks and overpowers him, he takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. Jesus is here saying that there are two kingdoms that are being that are clashing. That in Jesus' ministry and the high point of his death and resurrection, these two kingdoms, if you will, the kingdom of Satan, as he says earlier, and then this other king, this other stronger man, they're clashing. And there are these two figureheads, the strong man and the stronger man. And he's identifying himself as the stronger man that has come to drive out the strong man. Jesus is saying, I'm coming to drive out the evil one. But people want more signs. They want more flashing experiences. They want to see more demons cast out, more healings, more shock and awe. They want it. They want a good show. And Jesus says, you are a wicked generation who seeks for a sign. The only sign I'm going to give you is the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was a sign to the Ninevites, so also will the Son of Man be to this generation. And Matthew, in his account, he makes it even more explicit what this sign is. It says, for as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Resurrection is the sign of Jonah that demonstrates to Nineveh and all the kingdoms of the earth and every pretender to every throne, every alternative worldview, that the stronger man has come, that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is here, and that the sign that his way is greater, the proof that the way of the kingdom is superior, your apologetic, that the way of Jesus is greater than any other way in this world, is the resurrection of the King. Because he humbled himself, taking the form of a servant. He took on flesh and he suffered. He then rose in glory and brings all who believe in him into that glory as well. Our King transforms the perishable into the imperishable. Our king tasted death so that we might drink deep from the waters of life. Our king entered into the grave and walked out victorious. Our king subdued death and hell and the devil himself. Your king can't even subdue inflation. Our king is exalted to the throne of his kingdom, and it is at that throne that every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. It is before that throne that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And why? Because he is risen. He is risen indeed. That is the character of the message that you carry with you. That is the confidence that undergirds your work as you go to the ends of the earth, proclaiming the kingdom of Jesus. But as we proclaim, are we to proclaim triumphalistically, thumping our chests? No. No, we proclaim according to the character of the one who took up a cross on our behalf. We're called to take up a cross and follow him as disciples. Our message is not seasoned with triumphalism. Our message is seasoned with tears. We see that here in the text. Paul says twice, I serve the Lord with great humility and with tears. He says, I haven't hesitated to proclaim anything to you publicly or house to house, but he did so with tears. He says so later. He says, be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years, I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. With tears. One day we are going to feast as resurrected ones in the fullness of the kingdom. But until that day, it is ours to suffer as our king once suffered. Take up your cross, Jesus said to us. So we don't practice triumphalism because we have to endure suffering before enjoying the fullness of our resurrection. And so, brothers and sisters, global workers called by God to proclaim the kingdom of God to a world in desperate need of that glorious message, your work is a call to suffer. You suffer because you will be global workers, missionaries, who will see up close the brokenness of this world and all of its sin. There will be days that it will crush you, and you will persist in proclaiming the kingdom with tears. You are going to see the rebellion of sin in the people that you love, maybe even in family members while you're on the field, team members, and you will weep over the brokenness of your own heart. And you will persist in proclaiming the kingdom, but with tears. And you are going to see the eternal consequence of what happens when someone who persists in their rejection of Christ and his kingdom, you will see what happens when they persist and then die, and you will be left weeping. The tears will flow, and you will suffer. But Paul said that his life was worth nothing to him. And his only aim is to finish the race and complete the task that the Lord had given him. The task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. The task of proclaiming the kingdom. And there will be weeping. But you will persist, not in your own strength, but in the strength of the one that helped Paul persist in his ministry. Not only will you weep in your work, we will weep as well. Because there's one more place in this passage where weeping appears. The tears of the messenger are not the only tears shed in this passage. After Paul said goodbye to the Ephesian elders, they all knelt down to pray. And the text says that they all wept as they embraced him and they kissed him. And what grieved them the most was his statement that they would never see his face again. We are going to bring you up here, and you will kneel, and we will lay hands on you. And you will have taken vows that you are willing to pursue this task of proclaiming the kingdom even under threat of death. We will lay hands on you, and we don't know if we will ever see you again. And we will weep. And that weeping is right, and it is good. But the weeping is not the end. Because a friend of mine shared, these are some of the most remarkable words he's found in the book of Acts. The passage ends this way: then they accompanied him to the ship. This week we accompany you to your ship. And we will weep, but then we will send you in the confidence of the resurrection, knowing that whatever suffering you face in this world as you proclaim the kingdom of Jesus, it will be worth it because Jesus is worth it, because the kingdom is greater than anything else this world has to offer. And the weeping will eventually give way to great joy. We will only weep for a short time because there will be a day when the kingdom of God that you proclaim, that we proclaim, it will descend and be manifest in its fullness on earth as it is in heaven. And we will celebrate together resurrected ones in the resurrected one, in the glory won for us by our Savior Jesus Christ. What a glorious day that will be. Let's pray. Father, you call us to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of Jesus Christ in a world that needs it, but also hates it. And so as we do so, there is opposition. As we do so, there is suffering. Sustain our brothers and sisters as they go from this place. And would whatever weeping takes place here, would that give way to the joy of knowing that they are following your call, the same call that Paul followed, to finish the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. Empower them by your Spirit to proclaim the kingdom no matter what suffering they must endure in order to do so. Lord, we do this work. We commission these brothers and sisters in the confidence of the resurrection, knowing that one day we will feast together at your table, resurrected in your power, giving you all the glory and honor and praise. We long for that day. We love you and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.